My name is Mrs. Curtis.
And I'm Miss Palma.
And we are the faculty advisors for the One Love Club on campus. As you learned on Friday, One Love is a foundation that supports and educates young adults on the importance of healthy relationships. Miss Palma, Mr. Curtis, and I all have close ties to the foundation, and it means a lot to us. All three of us lived in the lacrosse world in 2010, and our lives were changed by Yardley Love's untimely death at the hands of her boyfriend, George Hughley. What I think most students don't understand is that George Hughley and Yardley Love were two exceptional students from great prominent families. They both attended private schools, had tons of friends, and were top athletes at the University of Virginia. No one ever expected their relationship to end so horribly.
The main thing that we heard after the terrible event from players, coaches, families, and friends close to both families was what if? George had become more aggressive on the lacrosse field and at parties, and he had become more possessive of Yardley over time. What if one of their friends had said something? What if one of their players had said something to the coach? Would George have gotten the help that he needed? Would Yardley still be alive today?
Fifth and sixth formers, you are about to head off to college, where you may encounter something like this yourself, in your friend group, or in your community. Will you be the person who is strong enough to say something? Speaking up is never about getting somebody in trouble, and always about getting them the help that they need to create better relationships in the future.
According to results of the National Intimate Partner in Sexual Violence Survey and the USTS Survey, Department of Justice, Bureau of Justice and Statistics, intimate partner violence in the United States, over 1 in 3 women, nearly 1 in 3 men, and over 1 in 2 trans or non-binary people will be in an abusive relationship. Only 33% of teens who are in an abusive relationship ever told anyone about the abuse. John Hay is generously doing an offertory for One Love today. 100% of the proceeds from today's offertory and from our Yards for Yardley event scheduled on May 7th will be donated to the great work they are doing in Yardley's name.
Her family's mission to educate young people on healthy relationships with a goal to prevent horrific incidents like what happened to Yardley from happening again is necessary and important. We are excited to continue and support it here at Westminster School.
The rewards for those who persevere far exceed the pain that must precede the victory. Ted Ungstrom.
Don't take criticism from someone you wouldn't take advice from. Aaron Gulab.
You can't always control who walks into your life, but you can control which window to throw them out. Unknown.
You have been criticizing yourself for years and it hasn't worked. Try proving of yourself and see what happens. Luis L. Hay.
You forgive, you forget, but you never let it go. Bad Blood Remix, Taylor Swift, and Kendrick Lamar.
Good morning. My name is Elizabeth DeBlasi, and I'm a sixth former from Monroe, Connecticut. The first time I stepped foot on campus, I knew I wanted to come to Westy. It looked and felt like somewhere that I could be happy. So, I did everything in my power to convince my parents, mainly my dad, to let me attend, including making a PowerPoint presentation. Yes, a PowerPoint presentation. In the end, it worked, obviously, and I joined Westy as a new fourth former. I was so ready to get out of my hometown. Don't get me wrong, I love it there, but it felt small and like there wasn't much freedom. I saw Westy as a chance to be independent as you can be at a boarding school, but independent nonetheless. It was a chance to try something I thought was impossible, and it was a place where I could be challenged in all areas, especially academically, as I included in that lovely PowerPoint presentation. I joined Westy right in the middle of COVID. If you weren't here during COVID, then it's pretty difficult to imagine what it would have looked like. There was a lot of Zoom, so much free time, a dining hall with only two chairs per table, and masks everywhere. It was a lonely place, and as much as the faculty tried to encourage and help us, there wasn't a lot they could do. But at the time, I didn't really mind. For the first few weeks of school, my time was either spent in armor or in my room, either watching Netflix or FaceTiming my friends from home. There wasn't a lot of social interaction that I looked for. I was doing the bare minimum in order to get by, and because of COVID, it was working. Then, thanks to Coach Wass and Priscilla, I was dragged out of my room and onto the quad. They lured me out with the promise of sun and soccer. I couldn't resist. Me and Priscilla, we would kick a ball around for hours and then do some of our homework out in the sun. I went from a dark, lonely room to a bright, busy quad. The quad is where I met the people who I thought were going to be my closest friends. And for the fall term, they were. If I needed somewhere to go, I could count on them either being out on the quad playing volleyball or in Fern, breaking every COVID rule you could imagine. While it lasted, it was great. However, during winter term, I felt myself slipping away. It was small at first, a subtle missed message or an unshared plan, but it slowly turned into obvious avoidance and exclusion. I didn't know what to do. They were my only friends on campus, and I was scared of what would happen if I lost them. So, I changed. I started to adapt my personality to match those of some of the other people in the group. At first, it was little phrases that they would say. Then it was their attitude, and then it was some of their views. By the end of the winter term, I was a walking shadow of my former self. Changing myself, sacrificing myself, letting go of what made me, me. What did that do? Absolutely nothing. The people who I thought were going to be some of my closest friends left me without a second thought, some using my changing personality as an excuse. The last thing I heard from one of them was a simple text message telling me I wasn't allowed to contact or follow them anywhere. Just like that, it was done. Changing myself, attempting to fit in, trying anything to keep the only friends I had, didn't work. I left winter term feeling utterly alone. Something that I struggle with then, and still struggle with now, is accepting the way that I feel is valid. If someone wrongs one of my friends, you can bet that I'll be the first one confronting the situation and do anything I can to help them. But if someone wrongs me, chances are I'll be the one saying I'm sorry. The thoughts running through my brain of that spring break consisted of, people go through so much worse. You don't have enough reason to call yourself depressed. Or, it's not that deep. So what? You lost some friends. I got two therapists during that break, lasting only a few sessions with each. I couldn't open up. I didn't feel comfortable enough to share. I was terrified of being judged by what they thought, so I didn't give them a chance to help. After March break, I didn't come back to school until about a third of the way through spring term. I didn't feel any better when I came back, but being on campus was better than sitting on Zoom. With spring term came track season, and enveloped in track season came two bubbly personalities that pretty much yanked me right out of my funk. On the track, we were the distance duckies, If you know, you know. But off the track, these two gave me a home. During free blocks, you could find us in one of the second floor study rooms, doing who knows what and probably getting yelled at by the librarians to be quiet. I got pulled into a new group of people and found myself participating in a variety of things, like helping Tia with her film project, watching Gabby and Alexa play Ghost Hunters on Roblox, and climbing a tree with Simone and Emma. I was scared at first. I didn't want to open up just to get hurt once again. But as the term went on, I saw that they were different, that they were going to stay. They were themselves around me, even though some of them were very, very, very TMI. Over time, I trusted them, and they trusted me. With these people, I was able to be myself. They accepted me no matter what, and I didn't have to act any differently. One of my greatest fears is losing friends or people that I'm close to. It's terrifying. I'll do anything I can to prevent this from happening, often putting their feelings above my own or excusing bits of behavior that they do, even if it hurts me. It's not always a very happy way to live life. It involves a lot of buried feelings that are always there, lurking under the surface, waiting to bubble over. I often find myself lying awake at night, going through every interaction I've had throughout the day, searching for an anomaly, anything that doesn't add up, and always assuming the worst. There's no easy way out. It's not like I can just change the way I think. But one of the best pieces of advice I've ever received, control the controllables. Three simple words that my mom said to me. There are so many things in life in which you have absolutely no say in what happens. In reality, you're a grain of salt in the middle of a desert. You can't control what other people think. You can't control how other people feel. You can't control what other people say. But you can control how you react. There are going to be people who just don't like you, with reason or without. There are going to be people who talk about you behind your back, who start rumors with the sole intent to hurt you, and who make it feel like you can't go anywhere without being judged. This year, I've done complete 180s in armor, hid away in the WCC, and stopped going to the gym, just to avoid people. I rearranged how I went throughout the day, just so I could try and pretend that what they did didn't hurt me. But there's nothing me, or you, or anyone can do to change the way they act. As Taylor Swift said, and the haters gonna hate, 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 baby, I'm just gonna shake, 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 I shake it off, I shake it off. I know I sound hypocritical when I say this, but don't let what they say impact you. And don't try to change or sacrifice pieces of yourself to try and get them back. It's a losing battle that will only end in you getting hurt. Far beyond those people who hurt you, there are going to be people who love, support, and care for you, who will stick up for you no matter what, who will be a shoulder to cry on when you feel lost, and who won't turn away when you say I'm fine, and you're not really fine. From listening to One Direction on the Overlook, to having sleepovers every weekend, to relaxing in armor, to going on a run around the quad at night when it's snowing, your friends, your people, are always going to be there for you. No one here is the same. No one here is going to feel the exact same way as someone else. Not everyone here is going to like each other, and that's okay. But what's important is that you find the people who are going to make you happy and encourage you to keep going and not look back. Everyone here is special in their own way, and there's absolutely no reason that you should ever have to change or sacrifice pieces of yourself in order to make others happy. Live life according to you, not according to anyone else. My name is Elizabeth de Blasi. I'm stubborn, passionate, determined. I laugh a lot, and I'm not changing for anyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Hope when you take that jump, you don't fear the fall. Hope when the water rises, you built a wall. Hope when the crowd screams out, it's screaming your name. Hope if everybody runs, you choose to stay. Hope that you fall in love and it hurts so bad. The only way you can know, you give it all you have. And I hope that you don't suffer, but take the pain. Hope when the moment comes, you'll say, I did it all. I did it all. I owned every second that this world could give. I saw so many places, the things that I did. Yeah, with every broken bone, I swear I lived. Hope that you spend your days, but they all add up. And when the sun goes down, hope you raise your cup. Oh, I wish that I could witness all your joy and all your pain. But until my moment comes, I'll say, I did it all. I did it all. I owned every second that this world could give. I saw so many places, the things that I did. Yeah, with every broken bone, I swear I lived. Oh, 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 oh. With every broken bone, I swear, with every broken bone, I swear, I did it all. I did it all. I owned every second that this world could give. I saw so many places, the things that I did. Yeah, with every broken bone, I swear. Whoa, 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 whoa. With every broken bone, I swear. With every broken bone, I swear I lived.